Hello guys, today I will explain for you the meaning of the inherent torsion and the accidental torsion and how we can include those two effects inside ETABS software. Of course, in order to do this, we need first to start reading ASCE 710. For the diaphragms that are not flexible, or in other words, they should be a rigid diaphragm, we should include the inherent torsional moment which is caused by the eccentricity between the location of the center of mass and the center of rigidity. Therefore, as this distance or this eccentricity increases, as we should expect more torsion in the structure. Then it is a good idea, for example, to change one of those two locations by doing some kind of modifications inside ETABS to minimize the effect of the torsional response, okay? And we normally change the center of rigidity by changing or by adding more walls, let's say, or columns. Therefore, I can guarantee for you that the center of rigidity, which is just the same as the center of stiffness, is just related to the location and the stiffness of the vertical components. Then if we need to change the coordinates or the location of the center of rigidity, we may need to add some walls, maybe here or here. It depends on the case, okay? While it is unusual to change the center of mass location because we cannot change the masses assigned to the structure, or we cannot even shift the masses within the structure into different points because the mass is just based on the self weight of the structure and the assigned loads, and it's not feasible even to change those loads or to change any assigned load. Therefore, it is more practical just to change the CR location rather than changing the CM, okay? And now to obtain the center of mass and center of rigidity from ETABS software, we need first to run the analysis, but before that, we need to make sure that we have selected this option here from the set load case to run. We need to enable this option here to calculate diaphragm center of rigidity, and then we need to click run now. And before that, we need also to make sure that we have assigned a rigid diaphragm for all floors in this model, because without the rigid diaphragm, we will not be able to obtain the center of rigidity. Also, it is important to assign a rigid diaphragm rather than a semi-rigid, because if we assign a semi-rigid diaphragm, we will not be able to obtain the center of rigidity. And let me clarify more by going to this website from the CSI company. As shown here, it is not applicable to obtain the center of rigidity for semi-rigid diaphragm because the in-plane slab deformation for those semi-rigid diaphragm is not constant, or it is a variable across the section. Then every joint in this slab will have its unique deformation. And the center of rigidity is just derived based on the stiffness and according to displacement at that point. Then if we obtain different displacement at every joint within the slab, we will not be able to obtain the unique solution for the center of rigidity. While if we assign a rigid diaphragm, all the joints within the slab will behave similarly and they will be representative by just one point. And that's why we are able to obtain the center of rigidity based on assigning a rigid diaphragm rather than assigning a semi-rigid. But the most important thing here that regardless of the diaphragm type, the eccentricity inherent to changes in mass centroid and the stiffness centroid is automatically included in the analysis. Therefore, it doesn't matter if we assume the slab to be rigid or semi-rigid, the inherent torsion is already included in the analysis, but if we want to obtain the center of rigidity as a value, we need to assign a rigid diaphragm, okay? And now let's jump into ETABS software. We need to obtain the center of mass and center of rigidity by going to the display show tables. And we need to click here the option of the structure output, other output items, and the center of mass and rigidity. And let's export this table to the Excel. As shown here, we have two columns that correspond to the diaphragm masses. The XCM and YCM here correspond or represents the coordinates of the center of mass, while the XCCM and YCCM represents the coordinate of center of mass computed based on the cumulative masses, okay? And lastly, the XCR and YCR are the coordinates of the center of rigidity. And in my opinion, it is more accurate to compute the eccentricity using the coordinates of the cumulative masses. This will account for the effect of masses from the higher stores. Then let's delete the XCM and YCM here because we don't need them, and let's copy this table to the Excel sheet we are working in, okay? Also, I want to obtain the masses by story. Let's just do it directly by going to the show tables. and from the other definitions, mass data, mass summary by story. We need to copy those values. As shown here, let me zoom in a little bit. The eccentricity along the x direction is calculated by finding the difference between the XCR and the XCCM and divided into the length of the building in that direction. And since the structure exhibits symmetry along the x-axis or around the y-axis, there is no eccentricity in the x-direction as shown here. Therefore, we shouldn't expect any kind of torsional response under seismic forces applied in the y-direction, okay? However, since the y-coordinates are different as shown here, there is an eccentricity along the y-axis. This eccentricity can lead to torsional effect when lateral loads in the x-direction are applied, okay? Also, it is noteworthy that many building codes restrict the eccentricity to 15%, whereas in our case here, the eccentricity exceeds twice the permissible limit, okay? And as shown here, I'm determining the story and diaphragm masses and comparing them to the exact mass of the entire structure. Then, if you are curious about how to obtain the exact mass, please go and watch my previously uploaded video, which is part 8, I think. This one. And as shown here, the difference in the story masses is almost equal to zero, while the difference by diaphragm is around 160 tons. Then it's worth checking if this difference in diaphragm masses compared to story masses might impact the calculations of the center of mass and the center of rigidity. And for this reason, I have created three examples for obtaining the CM and the CR locations. In each of those examples, I have used four modeling techniques or four cases as shown here, focusing mainly on assigning diaphragms from the shell and the joint option and with or without the floor meshing, okay? For the case number one here, the diaphragms assigned using the shell option without the mesh for the floors. Case two is just the same as one, but here I have assigned the rectangular mesh for the floors. Case 3 corresponds to the assignment of the diaphragms from the joint option and without the mesh for the slabs, while case number 4 dealing with assigning the diaphragms from the joint option with the rectangular mesh for the floors, okay? Of course, in this example, I'm using this model with those element divisions, which is not the same as the final model. Here we have less number of segments of walls and elements. And in the early stage, I have saved this model into a folder called Perform 3D. And as I have mentioned before for you, I want to use this model to import it to Perform 3D software, okay? Then let's check the results of the center of mass and the center of rigidity for the first case. And as shown here, I'm always computing the difference of masses by diaphragm and by story. And as shown here, the difference of masses by diaphragm compared to the exact mass is equal to 45 tons, okay? Also, I have computed here the median results of the center of mass and center of rigidity because I want just to check the general results obtained here. In general, the eccentricity inherent in this model with those used assumptions is equal to 22%, okay? But keep in mind that the stiffness of all components is taken to IG, okay? Therefore, there is no reduction in stiffness in this model used for this example, okay? For case number 2, as shown here, we have obtained the same location of the center of mass, while there is just a small difference regarding the computation of the Y coordinates of the center of rigidity. And this is because we have assigned the mesh, therefore the distribution of force inside this system varies a little bit compared to the first one, okay? However, the difference is just minor. For case number 3, as shown here, we got zero difference in masses for story and diaphragms. And if we check the Y coordinates of the center of mass with case number 1 and 2, we can find that those values are changed a little bit, but of course they are so close to the first ones. And also we got a different values of the Y coordinates of the center of rigidity compared to case 1 and 2. However, the difference also is just minor. And in general, the eccentricity here is equal to 22%. For case number 4, we got here wrong results of diaphragm masses. Also, the difference in masses here is too large now. The Y coordinates of the center of mass is not same as the first 3 cases. while the y-coordinates of the center of rigidity is just similar to the first three cases with minor differences, okay? But this modeling technique is wrong because if we want to assign the diaphragms from the joint option, we need to remove the mesh. Because the internal joints created by the mesh are not selected and included in the assignment of the diaphragm from the joint option, and that's why the lump masses over those virtual joints are not included in the assignment of the diaphragm, and that's why even we got a wrong result of masses. Therefore, case number 4 shouldn't be used, okay? And let me show you those nodes to make things more clear. The shell and joint diaphragms have the same purpose, but the shell diaphragms are preferred because they automatically constrain the assigned mesh internal joints. Therefore, there is no problem of assigning a mesh for the floors and then assigning diaphragm from the shell option because the internal joints created by the mesh are included in the assignment of the diaphragm from the shell option. But this is not the case when we are using the diaphragm from the joint option, okay? The virtual joints of the created mesh or the assigned mesh are not constrained or included in the assignment of the diaphragm. Therefore, when using joint diaphragm, manual floor meshing is required to ensure that all the joints are constrained and selected in the assignment of the diaphragm, while the shell diaphragms allow for the automatic meshing, okay? And to improve the accuracy, particularly in case number 3, I have divided the slab and wall elements into smaller components as shown here in example 2. Of course, I have ensured the good connectivity between elements, and this manual meshing approach should enhance the accuracy of the obtained results. And as shown here in case 1 and 2, we have got the same difference of masses, which is 98 tons. And since this difference is just the same for both cases, we have got the same y-coordinates of the CM, okay? Also, if we compare the first two cases of this example with those of example number 1, we can see that the difference in diaphragm masses is getting bigger. And this is actually the reason why we are getting the different y-coordinates of the CM, because the masses are not the same, okay? And this inaccuracy in computing the diaphragm masses arises because some of the assigned masses are left out and not included in the assignment of the diaphragm from the shell option, okay? And if we check case number 3 here, we can see that the difference of masses is equal to 0. And if we compare case number 3 of this example to case number 3 in example 1, we can see that we have obtained the same y-coordinates of the CM. Therefore, this similarity in results is because the diaphragm masses are just the same in both models, okay? And of course, regarding case number 4, as I have mentioned for you before, this modeling technique is wrong, but I'm using it just to illustrate how the inaccuracy in mass calculations can impact the results of the CM coordinates, okay? Lastly, I have created this example that have the same element division as the case study or the model we are using for the case study. However, the only different thing here that I have modified all the modifiers to IG, because in example 1 and 2, the stiffness of all components is taken as IG, okay? And as shown here, the difference in masses by diaphragm is equal to 160 ton. And the y-coordinates of the CM is not the same as the other cases. However, those results of the y-coordinates of the CM and the CR are similar to the other cases, okay? Also, in general, the inherent torsion from this accurate model of case number 3 is around 22%. However, here, we have obtained it to be around 24%. Therefore, this inaccuracy in obtaining the diaphragm masses increases the inherent torsion by 2%. Lastly, since I have decided that this model can be considered to be the most accurate one, I have saved it into a different folder and I have modified the stiffness of all components using the table here. I'm trying to make this model similar in stiffness to the model used in our case study, and I want to make the comparison between those two models. Of course, in our case study, we have assigned the diaphragm from the shell option and we have used the rectangular mesh for the floors. While in this model, I have assigned the diaphragm from the joint option and I have removed the mesh, and I have performed the manual mesh for the walls and the slab elements, okay? As shown here, the difference is zero in masses. The eccentricity is around 23%, while in our studied case, it is around 28%. Therefore, this inaccuracy in computing the diaphragm masses or lumping the masses into the correct location impacts the calculations of the coordinates of the CM and the CR. And as shown here, we have even obtained the same Y coordinates of the center of mass if we compare it to the other cases with different stiffness. For example, in this model, we have got those values of the CM coordinates, and I'm using here the IG for all components. And with the same model, but with different stiffness, we have obtained the same CM coordinates. Therefore, as I have told you before, the computation of the CM coordinates is not related to the stiffness of the components, while the computations of the CR are related to the location and the stiffness of the vertical components. And after all of this long discussion, let's say, I can fairly say that we need to switch to this model. We need to use the same model used in example 2. I have performed here the manual mesh for all elements like the slab and walls. And I think we should use the same modeling assumptions of case number 3 because this is the most accurate model, okay? Also, the second reason that in our model used for the case study, the eccentricity is already too large, while here it is lower. And the third reason of using this model that in Performer 3D software, we will use the same modeling assumptions. I will assign the diaphragm from the joint option. And as I have told you before, there is no assignment of the mesh for the slab elements. Therefore, in this way, we will make the models in both softwares more compatible. And this will lead to more accurate results and more compatible results. Also, I would like to end this video here because it is already too long. Then stay tuned for my upcoming video where I will explain the topic of the accidental torsion.